the head surface. So you can see the numbers or percentages that we're dealing with. Then the parts that would potentially be exposed, most likely, you know, most of us are going to be wearing a jacket covering up our body, but if it's getting or exposed, it's going to be the head location. It's just a larger area of exposure potentially. Additionally to that, then there are internal reasons as to why kids are more at risk than adults as well. And so I think whereas we think about our typical Wisconsinite adult compared to our kid, we do see that our pediatric patients have less subcutaneous fat, which acts as insulation to prevent hypothermia in us as adults, however, is not present in children. And you also notice as well, kids have a much lower ability to shiver, which is one of our, as an adult, primary ways to create energy and create heat to help prevent hypothermia and those sort of related injuries. So one thing that comes to mind is why should we care, either as just a layperson out in the community or as an EMS provider? And if you were to go on Google and search or go to the AEP website or on CWC, a lot of these different general resources that I think parents end up finding themselves to, the first thing that it says what to do, screenshot from there, is call 911 at once. So a lot of these patients and people that are going to be experiencing these sort of injuries from cold, specifically hypothermia, it's going to be you that's going to be the first one responding. And so having a little bit of knowledge of how to best manage this and not make things worse is important. But really with any injury type thing or this sort of processes that we see, the best way to treat it is really to prevent it way on the front end. And we hear that over and over, but making sure that we're, especially with our kids, making sure they're covered. And like you see in this little picture here from the CDC website on the two-page handout that they have on preventing cold-related injuries shows the importance of the hat and the scarf and really keeping as much, especially in our kids, of that top part covered, as that's going to be the area that's going to be most exposed and most likely to be injured. But then emphasizing the other extremity coverage with the mittens and layering, as we all growing up in Wisconsin here know what's important from that standpoint. But again, prevention being key. And when it comes to hypothermia, using our frozen that I'm sure we've all been subjected to hundreds of times at this point, felt that it was a nice way to portray your versions of mild, moderate, and severe hypothermia as kind of goes through the different layers here toward the end of that movie. You'll see there's through those three stages to it, and the temperature is listed in the second column there being degrees Celsius, where at the moment when we find an individual or see us, it's more likely that we're going to be basing it off of a lot of these symptoms that we're seeing, not necessarily knowing exactly what their temperature is. And so earlier on, like we all have probably experienced some degree of this mild hypothermia where we develop the shivering and it goes from, you know, your hands feeling cold to all of a sudden now they just don't feel as cold as much, and you kind of forget caring about that necessarily. It's pretty rare to get to this moderate level of hypothermia, and this is where if someone's really needing medical care, probably where they're going to end up in most of these cases. And so that's when you start seeing some of this confused state, talking gibberish, or really just seeming overly tired compared to what they typically are like, compared to your severe. And this is where is really, once you get down below 28 degrees Celsius, is pretty profound hypothermia. And these are the cases that really only occur when someone either has some sort of injury and is trapped outside, or oftentimes in our older adolescent population, some sort of either alcohol or ingestion that has come into play as to why they've ended up in such a situation. Or in our young kids who have fallen through the ice and find themselves in cold water, unfortunately. And so those are the symptoms kind of watching for: initially shivering, more so in the mild, kind of that altered mental status type behavior in the moderate, and severe, really pretty non-responsive. One thing that I do like to point out over on the side here, you know, list, in your infants, especially to keep in mind on, is that second bullet point of the very low energy. And so this is, like we talked about, without really kids, especially our young infants, being able to shiver, we're not going to see that as the first sign. It's really difficult, we find, even with any infant under 1 year of age, to really determine what their true mental status is. And so that very low energy is probably one of the key signs that's different than your adults early on that I would pay close attention to, especially if you're dealing with a young child. from a treatment standpoint, then, if for hypothermia, mild, we're really looking at just doing your pretty typical external type treatments with applying blankets, making sure the air in the room that you bring them in is warm. If it's a child that is wet from falling in water, getting those wet clothing off them to help warm them as quickly as possible. Once we're getting to the moderate level, again, not a huge amount of difference you see. We'll, in the hospital setting, sometimes get out what we call a bear hugger, where it's the forced warm air that's going through essentially a mattress underneath the patient. And so it's adding a little bit more warmth through that direct contact. And we'll sometimes also heat the oxygen and nasal cannula that they're breathing in to do some internal warming by them breathing in that warm air. But it's really not until that severe part where we start doing more invasive measures to warm patients more quickly. And so when we get to that point, the steps that we use typically is first with IV fluids that are warmed. And the recommended temperature is 40 to 44 degrees Celsius. But again, any temperature, room temperature or more is better than just being careful that the room temperature water, when we're giving that, you know, is coming out at 75 degrees Fahrenheit, which is clearly below normal body temp. So we just want to make sure that we're at least at what our typical body temp would be. NG lavage, we'll sometimes put an NG tube down and similarly use those same warm fluids that we're flushing out into the stomach and back out. And similarly, bladder irrigation by placing the Foley and flushing those same warm waters through the bladder as well to cause some internal. One thing to note is a lot of these measures that we're doing in the mild or moderate are done pretty passively. We don't want to do it too quickly and really focusing on the core. So that's what we talk about, the central rewarming. And the reason I mentioned that then bleeds into the last point here of after drop. So after drop is a concept where when someone is very hypothermic, their extremities have, the vessels have clamped down really tightly, and we have the coldest blood of anywhere in our body way out in the periphery. And so if the first thing we do is really quickly warm the extremities with warm water, warm air, whatever it may be, you have a essentially a quick vasodilation of these peripheral vessels. And so the blood that's now sitting in there has not yet had the chance to warm, but it's not being held there. So it rushes back centrally into the patient's body. And what happens then is you have this degree of what was at least somewhat warmed blood centrally and the really cold blood peripherally that now rushes centrally and drops the patient's temp even more. And so it's very common that you'll actually see with some of these more moderate to severe, the temperature will start out at one level, drop a little bit initially, and then come back up. And that's expected as that peripheral blood comes centrally. But we just want to make sure that we're not doing that too quickly, because that's where you start seeing some of the real detrimental effects of your dysrhythmias that sometimes get you in worse situations. And so that's why in the really severe cases, we'll start with some of this more centrally located warming type procedures to prevent that from happening. And then last ditch, this is where I talk about in general with cold stuff, not much has changed throughout the years, with the exception that I was thinking, I don't know if any of you guys out there have one of these, but it looked like a pretty cool ambulance setup, something that we could probably use here by us. But it's just get them on board and get them to the hospital as quickly as possible. And so one of the newer technologies that we do have this year is a picture of an ECMO circuit. And so we can put patients that are profoundly ill and even pulseless from hypothermia onto an ECMO circuit. And I've had some great results in actually doing some work with local EMS on the adult side around some of these efforts. But similarly with adults, with pediatrics as well, we have that capability that by putting them on that ECMO or heart lung bypass machine, you can warm their blood up and get some pretty impressive outcomes with that. So moving on from there, outside of hypothermia, one of the other things that we sometimes see with cold-related injuries is frostbite. And so this, for those who have not seen this painting before, is a picture of Napoleon during the War of 1812. And this is where we actually learned a lot about kind of the initial effects of frostbite from this war, when he marched all his men through Russia during the dead of winter. And the part I'll get back to, the interesting part that he keenly picked up on but didn't totally figure out what the reason was at the time, was that he had noticed that after these nights or these days of marching, that at nighttime they would start the fire to keep warm, and that it seemed like the men who were closest to the fire within the next couple of days were the ones that were more likely to get an infection and die from that infection. And so we'll touch on a little bit here, kind of where that came about and why that occurs. But when it comes to frostbite, there is really 3 degrees. Like I mentioned earlier, thinking about our external body surface area, almost like burns, frostbite is a very similar type presentation. So we have essentially a first degree, a second degree, and a third degree frostbite. And the degrees are really based on how deep that injury from the cold goes. And so if it really only affects the epidermal layer of the skin, you're looking at that first degree, which sometimes is called frost nip, but really the more mild ones. Whereas once you're getting down into dermal injury, then you're getting into that second degree or more superficial frostbite. And once you get down into that subcutaneous tissue all the way through the dermis, that's where we're dealing with the deep frostbite. And you'll see people, not immediately, but eventually will, as the picture kind of displays there, show the kind of darkening and necrosis of the tissue at the tips of those fingers. How it essentially confirms is a little bit complex, but the process as it goes from first degree down to third degree, as it's becoming more cold, the initial response is that you have, again, that basal constriction because of the cold, and so you have decreased blood flow, and that's what puts the epidermis, which is kind of that outer layer, at the most risk. There actually is what's called a hunter's reflex, which some of you may have noticed that it's a body's way of, once the temperature gets to a certain point, you actually have a reflexive vasodilation dilation of those vessels peripherally, and actually have a warming. And so you might've had that before, you feel cold, all of a sudden now it feels warm again, and then it goes back to cold, and that's that natural response. But once you get past that initial cooling response, what ends up happening is, because of that, you have water that leaks outside of your cells, and the water that leaks outside of the cells now is less constrained and more likely to freeze. And so you start getting some crystallization of the cells right around the vessels in that area. And then when the blood supply later returns to this area, what happens then is, because those blood crystals in the outside have kind of damaged those little vessels, you now have this blood that comes that with these leaky vessels, and now the fluid that comes leaks out. And so this is where you start seeing in the second degree here, where as that blood flow starts to come back, you get little bits of this clear blistering that occurs, which looks very similar, again, to what a burn would look like for a second degree burn a lot of the time, as those vessels have been injured, you know, have fluid coming back, leaking into that interstitial phase location. If it's bad enough from the injury, that's where you can start actually getting microvasculature clots, and that's where you start getting that third degree, is due to the compromised blood flow from the clotting to that region. So when it comes to rewarming, the key, kind of similarly like we did with the hypothermia, is to do it slowly, but slightly differently, doing it with warm water as well. And so again, removing that cold, wet clothing, the idea being passive warming though, not rubbing. And so I think it's always our instinct early on to rub our hands together to keep them warm, which is fine earlier, but once you're starting to get to that second or worst degree frostbite, the tissue is pretty friable. And so it's possible that you could further injure them even more just from the friction rubbing. And so the warm water bath really is the key to go with there. We do sometimes see that narcotic pain medications are required, just because, like burns, this can be pretty painful to deal with if it is bad enough. And so, kind of like I talked about earlier with Napoleon and his army, and what he was noticing with the infections in these men that he had sitting closest to the fire, this is essentially the reason why, is these men had frostbite, and then what they were doing is creating essentially a thaw, which occurred quickly by putting their hands and feet closest to the fire, and then would go back out the next day into the cold and would cause refrostbite. And it's this refrostbite that's really the most significantly injurious to the tissues around it. And that's the part of slowly warming it. So it was the men that were actually further away who had either the slow rewarming that was just enough, never really fully rewarm, and kind of maintain that maybe mild frostbite, that actually did better than the ones that had injured those vessels and had the leakage into the tissue that put them at higher risk for infection. The other side of it too, that I like to mention, a little bit different, but just because we live in Wisconsin and a lot of us are ourselves or our family members involved with ice fishing and potentially putting ourselves at risk for these, is some of the things that we do to try to prevent ourselves from getting frostbite and some of these cold-related injuries. And so one of the things that we often see are these space heaters that we bring inside the ice shanties with us, and just making sure to be careful that we're using appropriate heaters and that there's appropriate airflow and we're taking breaks as well, because there's a lot of these will produce carbon monoxide, which is clearly not good for us. And there's definitely been reports through the years here locally in Wisconsin, as well as around the area, of people going out and actually dying from carbon monoxide poisoning while being in their ice shanties overnight. So just to quickly touch on that, the mechanism for how carbon monoxide poisoning works is that the carbon monoxide has a much higher affinity for the hemoglobin in our red blood cells. And when it binds to that, prevents hemoglobin's ability to release that oxygen into our tissue. So it's there, it just can't get out of the cell for us to actually use, which is the problem with that. And there's really three different stages, again, mild, moderate, and severe. And it's somewhat based off of your percentage of carboxyhemoglobin you'll see here, but also depends a little bit just on the symptoms you're having. These are not exact cutoffs by any means in regards to the percentage. But early on, I think if any of us have found us in the situation where the gas stove is on or similar to this, that headache, nausea, vomiting is probably one of the more common ones that even at some of these lower levels of that 7 to 10% carbon monoxide, we likely start to feel. Once we get to the higher levels where people start getting significantly confused, as well as short of breath, you'll have patients that will pass out, and actually you get an increase in your heart rate and respiratory rate as well before finally getting to more severe, where you start having hypotension and respiratory depression at that standpoint. Treatment-wise is pretty simple. I mean, first and foremost, just get out of the environment. And as long as you're out of the environment, you'll eventually get better and it will wash itself out, so to say. But oxygen is really key. And so if you kind of overwhelm that hemoglobin with high levels of oxygen, eventually the carbon monoxide will be released and you'll breathe it out. You see here, this graph essentially just shows that different levels of oxygen. And so if you're on room air, you can see your carbon monoxide level will slowly fade down. And the general rule of thumb is whatever level you're at, the carbon monoxide percentage will decrease by about a half over the course of 3 hours if you're just on room air. Whereas if you put them on 100% oxygen, that goes down to about every hour, decreases by about half. And that's where you're seeing this second line here, that logarithmic curve downward. Now, hyperbaric oxygen is a therapy that only a few hospitals in each state typically have hyperbaric chambers for this purpose. But what it does is not only give the 100% oxygen, but even at a higher pressure level, and so forces even more oxygen into your tissue and watches the carbon monoxide out more quickly. In general, any level that's greater than 25% is what we shoot for. If the carboxyhemoglobin level is higher than that, we'll do hyperbaric. But there's also other signs that if a patient has loss of consciousness or their heart stops, or they're having significant neurologic dysfunction, or pregnant women at a little bit lower level, we'll put them in the hyperbaric chamber a little bit sooner. And the term you often hear for that is diving a patient, which is taken from literally if you go scuba diving, there's the increased pressure. And so that's where that terminology comes from. But in general, the key, if you're out in the cold and you feel like you're getting carbon monoxide poison, just get yourself out of that location at that point in time into the fresh air to help wash it out. And then one of the last things when it comes to cold-related injuries is wanted to bring up is the concept of the picture you see here. And so you've probably all had it. You're out on vacation with the family and you're thinking, we're finally away from the cold. There's no way that we can have any cold-related injury in this sort of environment. And then after you get back to the hotel after a day at the beach, you take a look at your daughter and realize that her cheek's red. And of course, wondering, did we miss a spot with the sunscreen? I swore we got that spot. And thinking back, like, no, we were very protective in the shade. And all we did last night, we came in, we got the ice cream to celebrate the first night we were here. And so then you're wondering back, is there an allergic reaction? And feeling that you might even feel that it feels a little thickened to you. And so this, what we're dealing with here, culprit, the bomb pop. So what this is popsicle paniculitis is the terminology we use for it. And so this is kind of a fun one that we see every now and then come through the ER during the summertime, but still have to think about cold-related injuries. And what this is essentially local tissue injury because of the cold temperature from the popsicle as the kid was holding it in their mouth up against their cheek. or as the cold liquid drip down the side. And the reason this occurs in kids is we talked about, in general, they have lower subcutaneous fats, but of the little bit of subcutaneous fat, we often see that kids have big cheeks, so there's a higher percentage within that cheek region, but it's also a higher percentage of specifically saturated fatty acid, which tend to absorb and actually hold on to that cold much more quickly than other fat tissue would. And so this cold temperature, as it hits that fat, causes local injury to that area. So the symptoms that you see, like you see in this other picture as well on both sides for this kid, is that erythema. And so that redness of the cheek and that circle area, it does tend to feel warm. But I would say the one thing that's slightly different, because I would say the most often reason we get these kids sent into us is concern for cellulitis or an infection of the cheek, is the third one, that induration. And so if you feel these, it really has kind of like a thickened feel to it, and is a little bit firm. And so it's, there definitely has to be some sort of history for this, because it very well could be an early infection or cellulitis. But if there's a good history that ate popsicle or outside eating ice cream or something like that, make sure to keep that in the mind. And treatment-wise is supportive, so there's nothing you need to do for this, other than that, no, the time course of this can take up to 2 to 3 weeks even before it fully resolves or the redness and that induration goes away. And so it does take a little higher index of suspicion, and far more commonly you're gonna see kids coming with red cheeks because of eczema or just wind chap from being out in the wind too long. But if your story doesn't seem to fit with that sort of situation and you're seeing this kind of redness and thickening of that side, keep this in mind, and knowing just a little bit of supportive care is really the route to go with it. And so a couple of the resources, in case you're looking down the road trying to remember some of this, that are good go-to resources for cold-related injuries, one being healthychildren.org, and this is a more global resource that's released through the AAP as well, which also has information on it, as well as the CDC has some good general information. We do Healthy Kids through AFCH, has some basic information, but for cold related injuries specifically, I felt like the stuff on Healthy Children was a little bit more useful. And so in general, just to review some of that cold related injuries, the most important in treating hypothermia is that prevention side of it, and so making sure we're dressing appropriately. And that I pointed out, especially in our younger kids and our infants, that tiredness or that lethargy is going to be one of the key signs to key in on compared to our adult counterparts, given that they can't shiver quite as well and difficult to assess for mental status in these young kids. From a warming standpoint, making sure that we're doing our best to warm the core first to try to prevent that after drop, so we're not getting the cold blood from the hands and the extremities rushing centrally to worsen things. And from a frostbite standpoint, making sure we're doing that passive rewarming either with air and if able to using the warm water to slowly rewarm that and not rub and injure the tissue further. And if you are out ice fishing and find yourself in a situation where you're feeling nauseated and lightheaded, being signs of carbon monoxide poisoning, making sure we're stepping out to make sure that we're in a well-ventilated area or preemptively doing that in planning processes. And lastly, beware of the mom pop. So if we're seeing any red cheeks on a kid after eating a popsicle, it can be a sign of that popsicle paniculitis, which paniculitis being the injury to the fat within the subcutaneous tissues there. And that's what we got. So with that, I'll just pause for a moment and see if there's any specific questions that anyone wanted to throw onto the cold-related injuries. Otherwise, I will transition over to COVID-19.
Thanks, Nick. sorry, we got one question in chat as we were going, which is, would ketamine be a better pain option for pain management to prevent increased vasodilation?
That's a really good question. Better? I don't know that I'd say it's better, but I think it's definitely a medicine that we use frequently for multiple different reasons. And I think I can imagine a certain situation, if it's to the point that the pain is so severe that we would need to do any sort of repair or cleaning of any sorts of that second degree injuries where it's getting to the blistering standpoint. I do know that our burn videoconference service does utilize ketamine from an IV, both pain and sedation standpoint for those type of procedures. So it is one that would be used. I think the only downside to it is that, at least as of right now, it does require either IM or IV version. And so a lot of these, we're trying to be able to have oral versions. So I would think the oral versus IV option is really probably the limiting factor there. But I think your thought process in why you're getting both that pain as well as a little bit of sedation and preventing further vasoconstriction is a good thought process with that.
Awesome. Other questions, feel free to throw them in the chat. Also, if you haven't introduced yourself on chats, if you're calling in by phone, obviously this doesn't work so well, but if you're in the app, just introduce yourself, let us know who you are, where you're from, who all is in the room with you, and then the code to text for a credit for being here and for us to allow to, for us to know how, that you were here is in the chat box as well. Give the floor back to Nick here.
Great. So to give a little update on COVID-19 and what this is here, wanted to just give a special thanks to Mike Puglia, who's one of my adult emergency medicine colleagues here at UW-Madison, who a lot of his work is around antimicrobial stewardship and does a lot of research around viruses and bacteria and otherwise. And so kind of used him as a key resource and helped me get a lot of the information that we have in the slides here today early on. So special thanks to him for that. And this will cover basically just a little background on what it is that we're dealing with here. And so terminology wise, what is COVID-19? What it actually is a coronavirus known as severe acute respiratory syndrome, which is what you get from the virus itself. But the coronavirus 19 is the virus itself. And when you get disease from coronavirus is what you see on the bottom here, coronavirus disease or COVID-19. And so when we hear this terminology, really that's the disease that you're getting from the SARS-CoV-19 virus itself. The coronavirus, it's a large enveloped single-stranded RNA molecule. And so this is a very beautiful zoomed in microscopic picture of what it looks like under the microscope. And the reason we're having issues with this is that it's known, the coronavirus of virus family of viruses is known to rapidly mutate. We hear all the time with influenza and how, you know, how good is 1 year's immunization versus the next year's, and it's always trying to get the specific type of flu strain essentially that's out there. And one of the reasons it's challenging from year to year is because every couple of years it's constantly mutating and evolving and changing, like it passed from one individual to the next. But coronavirus is one of the few that can actually be transmitted not just from human to human, but actually can go from human to animals as well. And so it's because of that that allows a lot more vectors within the virus's lifespan, essentially giving it more opportunities to mutate. And this current strain, essentially, we're seeing this coronavirus 19, is thought to have originated from this animal on the side here known as the pangolin. Which is one of the only scaled mammals that's left in the world and is present in China and thus thought in the region where it initiated, where it potentially or likely came from. The previous SARS type outbreaks that we had with MERS and SARS-2 were thought to be more associated with mammals such as bats in that area, as well as the palm civet cat. So this would be another mammal that lives in the region that can facilitate this sort of transition. And so what's new with coronavirus and with this? One is diagnostic testing, and this is on a daily basis. And you know, there's been, we hear a lot in the news, I think, about here in the US at least, about some of the delay in testing and why it took a little bit longer for the CDC to develop and release their new tests. And that's a lot of the challenges in the healthcare system we're dealing with right now is who do we test and how do we test because of some of the limitations of what's available. But big picture wise, honestly, I'm impressed. I mean, this is a virus, you know, essentially something that we had no idea what it was that we were able to key down on a virus. And not only that, put together like this whole PCR test to figure out what it is and test for it all within like a week's period, to me, is still just like amazing at what capabilities we have, you know, big picture wise, to be able to even figure out what this thing is to this exactness and what's going on. When it comes to transmission right now, one of the key things we're seeing about this, there is an early period where we may not be symptomatic, but might be able to transmit. And as well, we hear a lot about in the kids not being as affected is because there's a lot that are, but are relatively asymptomatic. And due to that, essentially are acting with these vectors to further spread the virus without going, knowing when it's going on. So those close contacts are definitely key to help transmit. Healthcare workers in general, we've seen pretty low transmission rates, both to healthcare workers as well as from healthcare workers. But a lot of that depends on the knowledge of the patient's positivity as well as the appropriate personal protective equipment that the healthcare workers are wearing. I'll touch a little bit on this R-naught concept and what that means in regards to virus and viral spread, as well as some of the pathophysiology about COVID here. This is just a funny picture of kind of early on what it was like and what we were trying to deal with, saying how the CDC was trying to catch up with COVID. So, but what, looking back through here, early studies showed that even back in the beginning of March, when we, you know, had suspected that it was there and had some really early test positive out in Washington, it was suspected that there was probably a huge amount more infected in the U.S. that had just not known that they had this infection at this point in time. Looking at the numbers, most recently, I pulled this off this morning and is from 2 days ago. You'll see kind of the typical we see is this bell curve type spread. As you know, there's one case and then another case and another, and it's kind of sporadic. And then all of a sudden it kind of starts to pick up, and that's where it really the spread from one to the next takes off. And so as you see toward the end here, the illnesses at the end are one that have essentially probably beginning right now and are affected but are not showing symptoms necessarily or reported. So that everything up to this point suggests that that curve will continue to go up at least a little bit more here early on. When it comes to just transmission of viruses like this in general, there's a couple of things that are important. One being the what we call the interval between your infection and your incubation period, and when you're exposed to when you actually show symptoms. And COVID 19 here has a pretty long interval between when you are initially infected and actually show symptoms. So that longer period allows for more time for essentially asymptomatic spread. That being said, there is a comparatively low R-naught, and the next slide I'll show you kind of how that comes into play. There is not evidence, at least at this point that we've seen, and seems pretty strong now, that it is not airborne spread, that it is contact and droplet spread, but especially in kids, we're seeing stool shedding can be a common way that this virus can be spread from children to adults. Given that they are often, from a respiratory standpoint, less symptomatic. And the stool shedding can occur even after fever is gone and some of the symptoms have improved. The standard cleaning measures seem to be effective right now in regards to cleaning surfaces. There's been some more recent articles that come out, depending on what type of surface it's on, can have a different half-life or how long that it can last for. But in general, as long as we're doing our standard precautions from a cleaning standpoint, it does seem to be effective at killing this virus. So I come to that R-naught number, and what that means is essentially how powerful is this virus at, if one person gets infected, what is the essentially number of people that will likely get infected by it before that individual can essentially identify that they are ill and kind of self isolate themselves. And so the COVID number we're looking, the R-naught tends to be right about 2.2. So compared to that to some of the other viruses and things we've dealt with in life, you'll see measles, which is why, for example, some of these we have such key reasons to get immunizations on and keep low, because once one person gets affected here, you can see in the average is that one person with measles will infect 15 others. And so when we hear about a measles outbreak, it's really rapidly that it spreads. And something that has, in general, R-naught that's greater than 2.5, we tend to think of as a virus that is not something that we'll be able to prevent the spread of if an outbreak were to occur. Compare that to MERS, which is another one of the coronavirus family infections, had an R-naught of 0.75. And so would say that if you're less than one, eventually the disease, as you see here, will die out just inherently in itself. And kind of similarly for Ebola, for example, is a very deadly virus, but at the same time, it's almost too good in the fact that it kills its host essentially before it has the opportunity to spread. So if you're less than that two down in this area, it's less likely that it will be a significant issue unless we're getting into larger numbers. Transmission-wise, this is some of the early data that looked at the first couple hundred cases we had in the U.S., and a lot was transmitted through household contact, and that being really your highest rate of how you would get infected compared to secondarily less than 0.5% from a community spread. So that was early on, and we're seeing less of that now. I'm going to save this. This I thought was just a cool, in the Washington Post here, if it works, showed kind of how different models of quarantine can essentially slow the spread of viral illnesses. And I'll do a couple of the models here for you. And so in general, if something is on an exponential growth curve up, you'll see here this, as I hover over this
screen. You may need to just change the screen you're sharing.
I think I will try that.
Give us like your different window.
Yep. Let's see that here.
I saw this model. It's super cool.
Yes.
Data visualizers are having their moment in the sun.
Right. All right. I apologize for the delay here.
Thanks to all the new folks who entered their details. It's great to see like a pretty solid turnout here. Do let us know if you have questions about COVID that you want answered. You know, if we can't answer them today, we are looking for all sorts of different ways, as I said earlier, to get information to you. So if there are questions that are really affecting what you guys are doing or what you need to know, let us know and we'll find a way to get answers for you and get them back to you.
Yeah, so sorry, are we able to see it now, Jonathan?
Yep, looks great.
Great, so this is just an example, the orange dots being people who are infected, and as everyone just kind of wanders around with each other, eventually the orange dots hit the blue dot uninfected people, and you see here as it goes, more and more people become infected, and then eventually at some point, some of these early infected people start recovering, and so as those are recovered, there's now less and less people that can get infected out there, and eventually it runs its way off. So you see if this is something that's spreading and has more than that R naught of one, eventually everyone will get infected within that location. Well, and then it will fade off and either this peer individual would either recover or die essentially. Whereas compare that to, we saw an example like this in China early on after it started, they said, all right, we are going to induce a physical barrier that is gonna prevent all spread from essentially this key city out to elsewhere in the world. But even under our best efforts, those barriers will often break down and you get essentially the first person that slips through that now spreads to the other area and then makes its way back. And so you can clearly see over time that everyone going through here under this quarantine is getting infected, but it's a much slower rate. And so this is where you keep hearing that term flatten the curve, what this means. So over that same period of time, people are being infected, people are becoming or recovering and getting over it. But it's taken much longer and you see that curve is much flatter over time. And so that's that essentially attempted quarantine model type picture. Once we get down to looking at our social distancing, this example here, we're looking at moderate distancing. So you're saying keep yourself separated. Some people are quarantined. Some are still making their way throughout. You definitely see that curve is flattened out over time, but eventually they make their way through and it will affect as well. And so this being that moderate kind of social isolation and distancing really helps flatten that curve a lot more. And compare that to example here where you have the one person, you have more extreme social isolation. So you have very few people that are actually moving around. Most are staying steady. Similarly, again, eventually it will get to it that a lot people will become infected and the early ones will start to recover, but it's really much flatter and takes a much longer time. And so this is where we talk a lot about that concept of hospital capacities to manage these, and that being one of the biggest contributors to our mortality with this, this is where this sort of model comes in. If that everyone is really doing the social distancing, that it can make a huge difference from what we're dealing with. So let's see, going back here then. So we're looking at this and just some of the other models that go kind of get to the iron out again is once we get over 2.5, it's a little bit harder to keep in track. So just to have an idea of how COVID-19 compares to other viruses, you can see right now a lot of these predictors put it in this kind of mid-range here. And so compare that like with measles, much more highly infective, but much less deadly relative to an example, bird flu up here. When that came out early in the 2000s was actually much more deadly. However, its infectivity to people was much lower as well. So you can kind of just get an idea of a lot of the other outbreaks that have occurred in this world and where COVID-19 kind of falls into that, similarly kind of relative to seasonal flu and otherwise. Some key clinical features of the early data confirmed cases, most will have fever. So 90 to 100% will have fever with this. A decent portion will have cough. And so that's why a lot of the screening we're doing is looking for this URI type symptom. Less so diarrhea though, and kids we're seeing a higher percentage that are having diarrhea with it. One of the key features of adults is this concept of lymphocytopenia. And so low viral white blood cells, specifically lymphocytes, is one of the key signs that we're seeing. And procalcitonin is just a measure to say most often, like, is there a bacterial infection or how sick are you? Tends to be pretty low. Compare that to kids and some of the early data. Again, there's very little data on kids just because so many have such mild symptomatology that we don't a lot of times know who does or who does not, and just don't have enough testing to be able to test a lot of kids to know yet. One key feature in the one study that came out of China did show pretty high levels of elevated calcitonin, which is interesting because that was one of the things that was quite opposite from adults. And this pointed at the thought process here is that we're seeing upward 40% of kids have a co-infection, whether that be with a pneumonia, an ear infection, or other viral illnesses that are affecting this elevation. So it's much more common for pediatric patients to have co-infections at the same point in time, which is not uncommon with a lot of viruses in kids. We see kids who are RSV and flu positive and rhinovirus positive all at the same time. They can have multiple virus kind of going through. This is now, seems like it should be up to date, but is about a week old, looking at fatality rates by country. And this is ever changing, by the day. But you see the mortality rate, right, tends to be in general average out right around that 4 to 5% range. Some of the higher ones, like we see in Italy here, again, like a lot of the news we're hearing is based on hospital capabilities, to manage some of those more severe, severely ill patients. Compared to the lower ones. USA, initial was 4%. I think right now we're a little bit lower than that, but that being said, we're still relatively early on. So there's a lot of patients who are currently in the ICU who unfortunately probably will die that will contribute to that. And I would not be surprised, depending again how much our public health efforts take effect, that we're not seeing higher levels, just because I think we have a higher proportion of older patients with other secondary diseases or immunosuppressed states than a lot of these other countries do that we're seeing. Just another way to look at it, when you break it down by age, in general, in the very young, we're seeing very low mortality rates. That being said, there are individuals who have died in this younger age range, and 1 out of 500, even as a 30 to 40 year old, is not nothing to balk at, but clearly we see in that older age group is where it significantly increases. And that's where a lot of the focus has been, is that the individuals down here are the ones that are moving around transporting this vector, where the ones being affected are the ones higher on. So it really is a true public health effort that getting the younger population on board to help protect the older. And a lot of these secondary diseases that go along with being older are some of the big key contributing factors as to why they're having such an effect. Just an example to make us all feel a little bit good, is South Korea experience actually showed early on had a similar trend to like we're having. And then the combination of more severe social isolation and social distancing, as well as high testing rates, really showed a downward trend in new cases. And they've had a significant drop, as well as a significantly lower mortality rate in that South Korea population because of the combination of the two of those, ability to identify early on as well as self-isolate and present spread. And that's where you see that less than 1%. So is possible that even if it does spread more broadly, if we do the right things to help decrease the spread rate, that we have the ability to take away a lot of the mortality with this. The key takeaway, especially for our EMS out there though, is really PPE is the most important. Like we said, you know, low spread to healthcare workers, thankfully. But the key part of that is making sure we have appropriate PPE. And so with this, if there's any patient that you suspect, key being make sure you're wearing your gloves to prevent contact. If you have a gown or some sort of external protection, it's good. If it's just your clothes, making sure you're washing these before you touch the outside with bare hands. Mask, always make sure to wear a mask. The surgical mask is sufficient at this point in time, aside from what we consider high-risk aerosolation procedures. So if you're intubating the patient, having them on CPAP or BiPAP, or using any nebulizer type therapy, really would recommend the N95 mask for the high-risk patients, as the surgical mask is not good enough. But if you're not doing any of these high-risk aerosolization type procedures, then that surgical mask is adequate. And eye protection, I can't emphasize that enough, is one that's often key forgotten. So if you have either eye shield or goggles or just extra large glasses, even something to protect your eyes as your last mucous membrane that I think we often forget about. And so going forward, because this is so rapidly changing, if you have questions, UW Health is pretty rapidly updating uwhealth.org/COVID-19. You can find a lot of resources here and link outs to the CDC also has some great resources. There is a lot of changing information out there, and you'll hear both good and bad. And I think it seems like day to day we're getting confusing and conflicting reports. And this is because it's new and so rapidly changing that we are just trying to ourselves get a hold on a lot of this. But that was hopefully gives you a little basic understanding of what the virus is as a whole, kind of the concept of viral spread and how it does occur. And the key part to prevent spread really being that social distancing practices that we're doing, as well as appropriate PPE for our EMS and healthcare workers when we're in the frontline environment. So with that, we got about 5 minutes here before we finish up. Open it up if anyone has any questions that they wanted to bring up on the chat board for us.
Thanks, Nick. That's awesome. I think it's obviously there's like a million questions around all of this, but I'm stuck at home, as you can tell. What questions are you guys seeing? What questions are you guys having? What issues are you running out there in the community? Yeah, and feel free to use the chat or your mic if you prefer. Just be sure to unmute yourself. What are you doing, Nick, in our ER in terms of like triage and directing patients and trying to protect yourselves and trying to keep patients, you know, isolated?
Yeah, it's a really good question. That's kind of the biggest key is both at the University Hospital as well as out at our American Center Hospital on the east side, kind of separation has been the key part. And so right up front, identifying individuals that may or may not have respiratory symptoms, and then essentially cohorting respiratory patients to one area that's located off to the side and non-respiratory patients off to the other side. And so at University Hospital, we kind of luckily have an old, you know, built-in area that we can quickly identify at the American Center. They've actually implemented a tent sort of setup like we see at a lot of these other national emergency sites to quickly identify and triage patients right up front and getting a mask on right away. Patients, anyone that is respiratory, to prevent further spread from themselves is key as well. But I would say that's probably then the biggest thing is separation. And then similarly within that area, also the cleaning type thing is making sure we're staying on top of cleaning those areas much more regularly and trying to put either dividers up, whether it's glass in between chairs or dividers if there's not at least 6 feet distance in between. The typical, just from a spread standpoint, if you give a good cough or a sneeze that that droplet would go, it tends to be right around that 3 to 4.5 foot range, which is why a lot of the recommendations for 6 feet separation tend to come up, with the idea be that if someone coughs, that droplet would not make it all the way over to you, unless it's under those situations, like I mentioned, where it's BiPAP or CPAP that's being aerosolized actually into smaller particles into the air.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Are there questions as we come to the close of the hour? Awesome. Thanks, Shelley.
Well, thanks for having me, John.
Yeah, thank you so much. You know, next month we'd planned to have someone in to talk about liver transplant, but since our rate of liver transplants is probably going down at the moment while we're dealing with the rest of this, and because of the ongoing sort of service disruptions, we are planning to have something other than that in April. Exactly what it is TBD, but I'm guessing based on our trajectory, it's going to be one of our infectious disease folks coming in to talk about what we know a month from now, which I expect is going to be very different from what we know now. But Nick, thank you so much for catching us up on current state. Stay safe out there, and we look forward to having you back soon, man.
Very good. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, everyone. Take care.